Hello to all of you who have decided to spend some time with us this morning, this afternoon on a Saturday for Lift Work Week. For those of you who weren't in the panel right before this, my name is Sophia Maya Guerrero and I am the Senior Organizing Strategist here at the ACLU of Colorado. And I honestly just could not be more delighted to be here talking about how you all as human beings who live in Colorado are best able to impact the change that we wanna see. For those of you who are really familiar with the ACLU of Colorado, you will already know this, but for those of you who might be new to this space, we are Colorado's oldest civil rights and civil liberties focused advocacy organization. And this year's LIFT People, which is for Lobbying is for the People Week, is really focused on making sure that you all have the tools that you need to elevate your voices, your stories, and your expertise to those who are in positions of power and who are decision makers in order to make sure that we have the best possible state and system that actually works for everybody, which we don't right now, though we have some pretty good things for sure. I also want to say for those of you who are more familiar with the ACLU of Colorado, you've maybe taken Know Your Rights trainings with us in the past. And Know Your Rights trainings are different than this because they're really focused on how you are able to show up knowing what you're already able to do, what you're able to advocate for, and what you're able to work on already. And advocacy trainings are more focused on know your worth than know your rights and how to actually like influence and create change. So we're going to start right now with about 45 minutes of talking about sort of that theory, that organizing, how you think about tactics, how you think about change. And then we will transition. We'll take a few minute break. Hopefully we'll have time for that. We'll take a little bit of a break. And then we'll talk a little bit more specifically about how a bill becomes a law and when and how to execute some of these principles at the state capitol. So with that, I'm gonna share my screen again. All right, I at this point have to assume that it's working and other people, y'all can let me know if it's just absolutely not. All right, so advocacy and action taken. I already told you who I am. Very excited to be here. So first, I really want to start with if people would drop in the chat what issue or value makes you want to do the work to be an activist. There are, 35, 37 people who are not paid to be here, who are here because you all, for whatever reason, think that it's worth your time when it is 60 degrees out and on a February Saturday to actually like be here in this space on this Zoom, learning these things, talking about civil rights, talking about justice, and talking about political activism instead of doing literally anything else. And so there's got to be a reason for that. I know that for me, I know that for me, I grew up in Alamosa, Colorado, which is in the southern part of the state, in the San Luis Valley. And I was also raised in a bicultural household. I'm half Latina, half white. And I was sort of always raised on this idea that you have to give back to your community in the ways that you can. And for a lot of people, that involves being a teacher or a nurse or, you know, running homeless shelters or other things that are really direct service. But for me, I like to think about systems change and I like to think about the upstream ways that we are working towards justice. And in Alamosa particularly, there's such a large gap between it's about half Latino or Hispanic and then half white. And, you know, obviously you've got people from all classes in both of those communities, but really that wealth gap, the education gap, and even opportunity gap for the Hispanic and Latino population that I was growing up in is just really stark. And that never sat right with me, especially being somebody who got to like operate in both of those worlds. And so once I was able to figure out how to help to impact change for my community, I had to. It's the only thing that that I feel able to put my energy into. So why do we organize? Why do we advocate? Why do we take action and community organize? Here are some reasons. We advocate for what's right. So I just talked about how I always witness these problems and it really bothered me. It never sat right with me. Those are my friends, my family, my community who are being systemically discriminated against and having obstacles put into their path that like I didn't have to have as somebody who's half white. Another reason is to change the system, right? We know that helping people in the moment is important, but we also want to make sure that we are changing systems permanently so that people can actually like access the things that they need more permanently. And again, to use our strengths, we all have different things that we're great at. The movement takes all kinds of thinking, all kinds of human beings. Some people want to be able to talk and do like what I'm doing, where it's like we're training and we're talking and we're doing these things. And like some people want to make sure that we are getting food to people. And some people thrive at building things, right? Like we all, whatever the skills are that we have, the stories that we have, the experiences that we have are all things that can help bring support and benefits our communities. And then lastly is to build solidarity. It can feel lonely when you feel like the system is working against you or the people that you love. And when we're able to organize and take action together, we're able to really feel that solidarity, and it makes us be able to do better work all together. And it also allows us to feel as a part of community rather than being isolated in us. I'm just going to take a quick moment to stare at the chat. You all are saying amazing, beautiful things about why you organize or why you take action. Human rights with a lean on houseless rights, environment, immigrant rights, voting rights, workers' rights, equality, rights for people living with HIV. I absolutely love all of these things. LGBTQ plus rights, mass incarceration and systemic racism, disability rights, decolonizing the movement. My God, these are really incredible. I will not take too much time scrolling through there, but if you all haven't seen, this is, again, a moment of solidarity. Like I'm speaking into a box in my office, right? Like I'm just on my computer, but I get to literally see that there's 37 other people, 46 other people, including my colleagues, who are like here because they care about things that I also care about. Like that's such an incredible way to be able to feel on a Saturday afternoon. So when we're talking about these different ways to support progress, one of the things that ends up really happening to folks, particularly those who are newer in the movement, is that we get burnt out because there's a ton to do. So something that I really like to root us in is thinking about what our own roles and lanes are. So this like illustration here, you can see it's got the little roof, it's holding up progress, and then these different pillars. And you could probably replace these pillars with various things, but I think that these four items are easy ways to think about your sort of theory of change, right? So like, again, I work for an advocacy organization. I work in community organizing because that for me is the thing I'm best at and aligns the most with my understanding of how to impact change and impact the system. But everybody has a little bit of all of the potential of all of these ways of serving. So one thing is direct service. Direct service, as an example, is feeding folks who need to be fed. It is getting blankets to people who need blankets. It is clinics that are free clinics or cheap clinics, right? Like Planned Parenthood does a lot of direct service in addition to their advocacy, as an example. A lot of the homeless and housing organizations in the Denver Metro do a lot of direct service. Direct service can also be considered being a teacher, like in teacher corps, folks who are in AmeriCorps, folks who are building trails, folks who clean up litter. Those are all ways to think about direct service, where you see the problem and you're fixing it in that moment for a set of individuals in like a very specific place and time. And then we have advocacy, and that's where we're going to obviously spend the majority of time talking today. And then another space is voting and other civic actions. So advocacy is definitely a part of civics and democracy, but voting is really this thing where it's, okay, we're working on the system in the most direct way. It is obviously not accessible for all people, and access to voting is a critical component of things that we advocate for. But voting in and of itself is something that helps to support that goal of progress. And then lastly is the actual government. So people who run and hold office, people who work for governmental agencies, who want to see progress, who are working towards progress within those systems, but they're actually like a part of and getting paid for and working within the actual structures. So really we need to see all four of those pillars happen. If we only did advocacy, but we didn't vote for or have anyone run that was great on our issues, that was really pro civil rights, that like wanted to see, you know, better access to democracy, that wanted to see the acute housing crisis be relieved. Like if we don't end up with any of that happening in the actual people governing, it does not matter how loud we yell, we will not have the votes. And then vice versa on the other side, if we are spending all of our time as a community advocating and there's no direct services, in the meantime, more people are harmed, more people die, more people aren't able to survive in order to get to that like better future. And so you see the way that these pillars all together have to work to support progress. Here's another way to think about this illustration is sort of on this gradient. So you have on the left, accepting existing power, and then on the right, challenging existing power. So you can see that direct service is accepting the existing power. It is radical and important to do direct service. I spend some free time doing direct service, but it is also recognizing that like doing direct service does not in and of itself change those upstream effects, and it does not change those systems. So then you can kind of look throughout that range, working for the government, right? You can make more change, but you're still within that system. So it's a little bit more accepting. You've got self-help and even education starts to be a little bit more on that challenging existing power. You've got running for office as like somebody who wants progress, a little bit more towards the challenging existing power. And you've got advocacy pretty far over there, but obviously all the way on the other side is revolution, which, you know, maybe people in their time outside of this space are interested in getting all the way towards the challenging existing power, but that's gonna be a different training. Happy to point you in that direction. But thinking about advocacy as something that does work outside of the system to try to change the system for good is, I think, a really critical way to think about the way we as advocates then exist within the system and our relationship to the system. I would also love to throw out there that I will absolutely look at the questions box. The chat box is really is being used well, and I think that's great. But please, if you have like questions specifically for me, I wanna make sure that I see them, and those I'm gonna be able to see in the Q&A box really specifically. Thank you so much. So this is our gradient of accepting to challenging power. And you can think about yourself and where you wanna be on this, and it can maybe help you think about what are the actions that you wanna be taking for this moment. So we're gonna do an allegory because I love a parable. This is one of many organizing parables. Those of you who work with me will eventually hear all six of them, but we're going to start with this one. And I'm going to read it to you. I know it's a lot of words, so you can read it, but I'm going to tell you this whole story, and then we're going to talk about like what are the theories of change. So once there was a small village on the edge of a river. Everyone was happy in the village. Kids played in the river, mothers washed their clothes there, and it all was good. But one day, a mother was at the river finishing up her laundry when she saw a body floating down the river. She calls for help, and a few folks nearby help her drag the man out of the river. He was barely alive, unconscious, and they took the man to the doctor for help. The next day, the man was still unconscious when some people on the river saw another body floating down. Again, they pulled the man out of the river and took care of him. Each new day, bodies came down the river, some men, some women, some children, and all needing help. As the village was doing their best to care for the people, one older man picked up his water bottle, walking stick, and started to leave the village. One of the villagers stopped the man and said, "You can't leave now. We need everyone to help take care of all the people that we're pulling out of this river." And the man answered, "It's about time someone goes upstream to find out why these people are falling in the river in the first place." So, what theories of change are illustrated in this story? You can put answers in the chat, but I obviously also give them away right here. I'm so glad you all are getting the transcript figured out. So sorry about that being bumpy, by the way, and seeing that conversation. So one thing is direct service. You got to pull people out of the river. And like, let's think for a moment how inhumane it would be if that woman who was doing her laundry decided to not pull that man out of the river. That's inhumane. We have to have humanity interpersonally and individually. We have to provide those direct services for those who need it in this moment. You can't leave the man in the river. Then the man who goes upstream and says, "What is wrong? What is happening?" This is a problem that needs to be addressed further upriver. That man is doing advocacy, right? And so you see the way in this story that it really does take both to solve social problems. All right, so we're gonna have a little bit of a transition. Let me pause and just check. Are there any questions in the chat? I don't see any. Okay, so the first thing, when we're thinking about advocacy, we've figured out that that's like the lane we wanna take. We figured out, like, yes, we're community organizers. This is what we're doing. Now, what's the point of organizing? It's to affect change. Building community for building community's sake is excellent, but the difference between building community because you're a good community builder and being building community because you're a community organizer or an activist is because you're trying to impact a policy or a system. You're trying to impact change in your society. And that is an important distinction. So the first thing that you have to do is figure out who your actual target is. So if you are, sorry, my computer just froze. Sorry about that. So if you are thinking about that you would like to see the minimum wage in the state be higher, or you are thinking about the current housing crisis, or you are hoping to have better police accountability, any of those kinds of things, there's often avenues to work towards change, both at the local, state, and federal levels. And we're really focusing this week and today on that state level ideation. But I just wanna recognize that these same questions and principles work on any of those levels. So figuring out who your decision maker is so critical because they're ultimately who you're trying to influence and who is in control of the outcome. So elected officials are most often the decision makers for policy change. It can be your mayor and city council, it can be the state legislature or governor, but it can also, something to think about with those things is that that's an individual or a body. So if it's the whole state legislature that is really specifically, you know, that's who you're going for with a specific policy, you have to think about there are dozens of people in the state legislature. So then really trying to dial in, like, which ones can you influence and which ones need to be influenced? Like, which ones are not supportive? Which ones are going to be the most excited and champion of your issues are all really critical to thinking about who to target and how. Because then the next big question about targeting your organizing and advocacy is what will influence your decision maker? So for electors, voters, constituents, are often incredibly influential because they're voted into office. And so having, you know, even bad publicity or good publicity is so important to elected folks. And that is one of the reasons that we are able to hold our folks accountable. But it can also be specific organizations, companies, or communities. So for example, a lot of legislators talk really specifically about wanting to be seen as supportive of local business or the business community. And so that's something where if you know that your legislator that you're trying to influence loves being seen as pro-business, try to get some businesses in with you to write letters or to show up to influence them. So then the next thing that you're gonna wanna do is take action. And there's essentially three main steps for this component once you've figured out your decision making. So one is identifying your ask. Something that we see a lot, and that, I mean, we're all guilty of, right? It's necessary sometimes, is that it is easy to see problems and it is harder to be a problem solver. And so yes, you are definitely always allowed to just bring up the actual issues that you are seeing to your legislators or other electeds, because it is part of their job to also help problem solve on behalf of community. If you have a more specific ask than just saying, like, I'm really upset that, like, the sidewalks in my neighborhood are trash, or like, I know that there is this apartment building that has been unjustly evicting people with regularity, having a specific ask attached to that, such as, will you support this type of policy? Will you run this certain policy? Will you meet with community on this? Will you take a stand in favor of housing justice? Any of those kinds of things are gonna be much more likely to yield results if you have that really specific ask. So for those of you who are able to join us in the Capitol on Thursday, and we will take folks grassroots lobbying, what we will have as your ask is who vote yes or no on specific bills. And so that is an example of a really specific ask. I would like you to vote yes on SB1. That is a good ask. So then the next thing that you're gonna need to do is pick a tactic. So phone calls to decision makers, emails, and letters are all really common ways to get your voice heard, and they are all good ways. I will say that emails in particular, lots of legislators do read their emails, but you want your tactics to also be relatively visible. And so phone calls and actually even physical letters end up taking up essentially just like more real estate, right? They take up a little bit more space and time. And so then people are forced to pay a little bit more attention. But you also see in the same realm, you can testify in hearings, which again, for those of you who are able to come with us to the Capitol on Thursday, we will teach you how to do that. And there might be opportunities to testify. It depends on what the schedule is this week. But there's also attending protests and even making public art. Art has been historically a really critical component of change from the civil rights movement, the Chicano movement. There's a lot of great examples in the environmental justice movement right now that are all really centered on mobilizing towards action. And then the last thing is to not go alone. Like I said, the thing about organizing is really about solidarity. And one of us, we all have the right to call our legislator and be upset. We all have the ability to talk through our problems, et cetera, but it's actually really hard to have the amount of influence that we need to have if we're doing it alone. I often talk about how a lot of either bigger business or corporate interests end up being in opposition to several of the things that we stand for within the civil rights and liberties space. And they have the money, and money really does talk, but we have the people. And so if we're able to all lift our voices together, we can be just as loud as their money. So here's an organizing quote, and then we're gonna do a brief breakout room activity, which I'm pretty sure I have technical permission for. But this is from Dolores Huerta, who is a great organizing role model of mine. Every moment is an organizing opportunity. Every person a potential activist, every minute a chance to change the world. Oh, I actually don't have the ability to make breakout sessions.
Give me 1 second. How many breakout rooms do you want?
Let's make 8.
Okay, give me 1 second.
Thank you so much. So what we're going to do in our breakout sessions is you're going to go back to your values that you were talking about in the beginning. So why are you here? What is the, like the either the issue area, the community, the like reason in your own life that puts you into this space, that makes this space important to you. And then talk about who your decision makers are, or like where you're hoping to be influencing decision makers, whether or not you've got like local folks that you're trying to work with or state folks, and whether or not they're actually like the legislature or the governor, or maybe an agency that needs to be working better. And then lastly, pick 1 to 3 tactics that you think would help to generate better visibility and then therefore support on your issue. And when folks come back, I'll have people drop in the chat their cool tactic, or if they ended up really aligned on a specific issue. Do those instructions make sense to people? Since I can't see everybody because of like the nature of the large Zoom situation.
Hey, Sophia. We just realized actually that we cannot do breakout rooms because this is a webinar format. Yeah, so sorry. So folks can just pivot to working on this, scenario by themselves.
Yes, we can definitely pivot for that. All right. So the first thing, and like, let's just go back to the chat, I would say. I really appreciated everybody participating in the chat at the beginning and like what values and things that you all are bringing into this space at this moment. So let's start with, if everyone can put in the chat, and I will repeat the question. What is a key policy or issue you want to help generate attention on? And if folks can just answer that question just within a couple of words. You don't have to get too specific. I promise I won't turn it into a law tomorrow. Awesome, Sean. Thanks for breaking the ice. Housing, yes. Voting rights in the Black community, fabulous. Rising fascism, also fabulous. Getting more clemency, yes. Oh, these are really great. Okay, so we're recording this, so we're gonna be able to, this is gonna be our new, you know, policy agenda setting, right, everybody? We're all locked in. Greenhouse gas emission reduction, systemic equity and environmental equity, ending the urban camping ban in Denver and beyond. Police misleading minors in interrogations. Fabulous, there's a bill on that happening. We will look forward to getting to work with you on that. corporate and university divestment from fossil fuels, cash bail, quality healthcare, accessibility, regulations on crisis pregnancy centers, school to prison pipeline, defunding police, documenting killing people and hiding behind the 11th Amendment. These are fabulous. I'm hearing actually a lot of different levels of governance there. So I'm legitimately hearing some like local things. I definitely heard a specific Denver thing, but it sounds like there's levels of accountability, things to do with the governor, things to do with the legislature. So we don't have to put this part in the chat, but given what you put in there, or if you saw one that you're like, yes, that's the one I want to like also be with, think about who your decision maker is. So somebody, for example, said increasing the amount of clemency that was happening, that's going to be your governor, right? And so targeting your governor might look a little bit different than targeting your state legislature, especially given that it's one human being and not a body. Somebody else mentioned something specifically about a Denver level issue, which, you know, after Denver maybe should be happening on the state, but thinking about, all right, targeting Denver level electeds is going to be different than targeting your state level electeds, right? So think about what are the 1 to 3 actions. Let's do 1 or 2 actions that you want to take based on trying to raise awareness on that issue. I'm gonna put it in the chat too. Speak openly and gain support. I love that. I encourage folks to think about specifically like who your target is and then like what your action is and then what your ask is. So for example, if I'm working on just cause evictions, I want to write an email to my state legislator asking them to vote yes on a just cause evictions bill. So I think, you know, making sure that you're really like pulling all of those parts together. Yes, thank you, Sabrina. That's great. Call, email, and go visit our reps. My ask and follow through. That's great. So is another thing that I was gonna have in breakout sessions, we'll apologize to everybody. But the last thing that I'm gonna ask of you, because I'm dropping in the chat, finding my legislator, and essentially you're able to put in your address or even just zip code, though that will not be as specific as is really necessary, to make sure that you know your state and your state representative and state senator, and it has their contact information. I really wanna encourage everybody clicking on that link, making sure that you're right. And also, even if you've been in this work for a long time, things were redistricted last year. And so I know that my senator actually changed. So make sure that you've got those correct, take note of their contact information. And I definitely encourage folks to write that email about the issue that you're having today. I definitely plan to write an email today specifically about just cause evictions. Who else is committed to actually writing an email to their legislator today? Anna or Anna, that's really great. I love that list. All right, folks, recognizing that we are running a little bit ahead of time, which is actually fully lovely, I am going to do 2 things. Yes, Laura, I love to see it. You are pledged to be writing a letter to your legislators today. Very, very pleased to see that. Anyone else who's committed, like, please add your add your emoji or your yes me into the chat. I love that, like, public accountability personally. Oh, look at you all go. We've got five or six. This is perfect. So I have two like pieces of housekeeping. One is that I'm going to send into the chat. You will also get a follow-up email, but into the chat, a survey where you can specifically put in feedback, and then recognizing that this is actually going to move into our next presentation, which Julian, I believe, is going to be leading us, who you can see here. But I want to give people like 5 minutes, I think, for folks particularly who started in the Ledge panel earlier, and I'm seeing with the names that there's a lot of that overlap. So just to really ensure that people have time to take care of themselves. So I'm going to put music back on. We're going to take until 11 past the hour, and then we'll come back and we'll go into how bill becomes a law and more specifics on how to like use these tactics like at the right times in the legislature. So that sound all right to everybody? Make sure that you went and you found your legislator. I love seeing those pledges about who's going to write emails to their legislators, and you can take the survey, but otherwise we'll be back. Well, let's call it 12 at 11:12. See you all momentarily.
Sophia, can you remind folks about the day at the Capitol event? There are some folks here asking in the chat.
Yeah, absolutely. So the day at the Capitol is on the 9th. So this coming Thursday, we're going to meet together to eat breakfast, talk to legislators, learn about some specific policies, and go over some lobbying 101 at 8 in the morning. And then we will have a day of scavenger hunting, doing grassroots lobbying. We'll have lunch. We'll get to talk to more electeds. And we'll take people to some various committees in the afternoon. And you are definitely still invited to register for that. I will drop that link in the chat for folks.
I'm in love with you. We're going to go ahead and get started on this third part of this day. Thank you for those who have stuck with us on your Saturday morning. My name is Julian Camera. My pronouns are he, him, his. And I am the field organizer here at the ACLU of Colorado. Sophia, do you mind sharing your screen if you haven't already? I cannot quite see on my end. And while she's doing that, I'll tell you a little bit about me. As a trans person, as a kid, it didn't take me long to realize that some people have more privilege and access to power than others. And that's no less true than when it comes to the Capitol, where laws are made. And so I remember a few years ago, there was a bill that was introduced and it would ban gender affirming care for trans youth. And it was sent to the State Veterans and Military Affairs Committee. And I had no idea what that meant. But an organization that I followed had asked for personal testimony, and I really wanted to yell at legislators and tell them how gross this bill was. And how as a kid, gender affirming care would have prevented years of depression for me. And so when I showed up, we waited hours to testify, and I heard brilliant person after brilliant person share their story and explain through logic and emotion to the point of no argument why this bill was so bad. When I finally went, it was like 10:30 at night and I was shaking, and I got to look the senator who drafted the bill in the eye and just tear him a new one in the most professional way. And it was incredible. And the bill was voted down. And me and the rest of the trans and queer people in the room, we just looked at each other like, yeah, we belong here. His laws do not. And from there on out, I felt really excited to go to the Capitol, and it's one of my favorite things to do. And I wish I did it more, because it's super empowering. And so what we hope to get out of this training today is that you walk away more familiar, more comfortable, and more confident in how new laws are made on a state level, and how you can get involved. And even though we as constituents and residents of Colorado are the true deciders of what laws are created at the Capitol and who creates them, there's a huge lack of access and education about how to access that power. So throughout this training, we're going to talk about one, ACLU's priority issue areas that we identified, and you can expect our policy efforts to focus on. And then we'll talk about the legislative branch and break down how it operates. And then we'll spend most of our time talking about how a bill becomes law and those peak moments for your participation in the policymaking process. So let's go to the next slide and do a little background. ACLU did a year-long listening tour. And this was in 2021, and we met with people from across the state, and we just asked them, what issues are you experiencing and what do you want to see change? And through that listening tour, and then through a lot of like internal planning sessions, we identified our new strategic framework and our issue areas. And so our strategic imperatives are racial justice, Indigenous justice, and immigrant justice. And those are the lenses for which we will address all of the below issue areas that we are prioritizing our resources. So we are going to focus on systemic equality, and that's going to be essentially housing justice, economic justice, and access to voting for Black and Brown Indigenous people of color. Our campaign for smart justice is going to focus on alternatives to policing, prosecutions, and prisons that address the root causes of harm to Black and Brown communities. And then our privacy and liberty project is protections against government overreach and threats from advancing technology, which is a new and exciting one for us. In this legislative session, you'll already start to see that we're really focusing our efforts around those three issue areas. So let's go to the next slide and hop into the legislative branch and its breakdown. So we have three primary levels of government. We have the judicial branch, which includes our county courts, our district courts, our court of appeals, and the Supreme Court. And this is where laws are evaluated. We have the legislative branch, and that's what we're talking about today. And that includes our state senators and representatives, and their primary goal is to make laws. And then we have the executive branch, such as our governor, or on the federal level, our president, and their main purpose is to carry out laws. The makeup of the legislature, this is two maps of Colorado. On the left, we have our Senate district map, and on the right, we have our House district map. Our Senate, we have 35 senators, 23 are Democrats, 12 are Republicans, and we have 65 House reps, 46 Democrats, 23 Republicans. And as you can see, the districts vary by size and population. As you get more into the Denver metro area, those districts are going to become more smaller and closer together. And then as you get out into the more rural areas, you might have one senator representing you in Durango, and they're also representing folks in Grand Junction, for example. And because we have a Democratic governor, we have what is called a trifecta. And that means that our Democratic Party basically has the ability to pass or oppose laws that align with the views of the constituents who elected them. That doesn't mean that they're just gonna pass whatever laws they want. I know a lot of our elected officials are trying to work, focus on being bipartisan at this point in, in this political climate. But with the trifecta, they're going to have less resistance than they would if there was a Republican ruled House or a Republican ruled Senate or a Republican governor. For leaderships and elections, when does the legislature meet? They convene every year between January and May, and they introduce and vote on hundreds of laws, and it's complete chaos, but it's great. Just ask our policy director, Anaya. And then each senator, they serve a 4-year term, and then each House representative serves a 2-year term, and state legislators are elected based on what district they're representing and what district they live in. And every term, the legislature elects the chamber speakers, the leaders, and they assign legislators to committees, and they're responsible for day-to-day operations of the House and Senate. The president of the Senate and the speaker of the House, they control which bills get assigned to which committees, and we'll talk about committees in a bit here. But as you can see in this little box, these are the folks that are currently our Senate and House leadership. Next slide. And then another big piece of the legislature, and possibly the most important, is the constituents, the people, us, community members, non-governmental organizations like nonprofits, schools, service providers, churches, businesses. We are the ones who elect legislators and influence the policies that they prioritize at the Capitol. And so we do this when we're electing the legislators. We have a ton of power to influence them. And influence public perception. And so we do this by voting, we do this by knocking on doors, calling and texting voters, posting on social media, educating our peers about why a candidate is a civil rights champion, and hundreds of other ways. And Sophia dove into some of those. And not only do we elect them, we also tell them how we expect them to serve throughout their term. So as I was talking about earlier, like there's a lot of misinformation or like missed opportunities for education about, you know, how much power we truly have at the Capitol. And the truth is that we're basically the bosses of legislators. And say a community is like significantly impacted by the housing crisis and they elect a pro-affordable housing champion, meaning someone who ran their campaign saying, I am going to fix the housing crisis. I'm going to support all of the policies that address the root causes of housing and affordability. And we're going to make sure that they live up to those promises. If they're not doing that and they go against everything they said, we're going to vote them out next term. But it takes everyone to be tapped into that. And that's the key here. And they're also going to work hand in hand. We're going to work with those legislators who are staying true to their promises. And we're going to support them as they're, fighting to make sure our civil rights and our civil liberties are upheld. And finally, we influence laws that are created at the Capitol, and we do this by participating during legislative legislative session beyond. And this can be done through community organizing, where we tell elected officials the laws that matter to us and what laws should look like. We write letters to elected officials and call them to ask for their support. And we also show up to lobby day, which random thing, there's a lobby day happening this Thursday, February 9th with ACLU. So please join us. And we also like show up and we share personal and powerfully moving stories face to face with legislators. As I mentioned above, that's one of the most powerful things you can do, because when a legislator is looking you in your eye, they're seeing the emotion, they're feeling the energy behind your story and how important this is to you. So now I'm going to show you a video of the classic School of Rock video of how a bill becomes a law. And then we'll kind of dive in, we'll break those pieces up and just dive in, like, what does this mean for you? Where can you plug in as a constituent, as a person, like individual living in a district? So we'll go ahead and get started with that. Sophia, can you share the sound?
Sure got to climb a lot of steps to get to this Capitol building here in Washington. Well, I wonder who that sad little scrap of paper is.
I'm just a bill. Yes, I'm only a bill. And I'm sitting here on Capitol Hill. Well, it's a long, long journey to the Capitol City. It's a long, long wait while I'm sitting in committee. But I know I'll be all over someday. Just I hope I will, but today I am still just a bill.
Gee, Bill, you certainly have a lot of patience and courage.
Well, I got this far. When I started, I wasn't even a bill. I was just an idea. Some folks back home decided they wanted a law passed, so they called their local congressman, and he said, you're right, there ought to be a law. And he sat down and wrote me out and introduced me to Congress, and I became a bill. And I'll remain a bill until they decide to make me a law. I'm just a bill. Yes, I'm only a bill. And I got as far as Capitol Hill. Well, now I'm stuck in committee. And I'll sit here and wait while a few key congressmen discuss and debate whether they should let me be alone. That they will. But today I am still just a bill.
Listen to those congressmen arguing. Is all that discussion and debate about you?
Yeah, I'm one of the lucky ones. Most bills never even get this far. I hope they decide to report on me favorably, otherwise I may die.
Die?
Yeah, die in committee. Oh, but it's like I'm going to live. Now I go to the House of Representatives and they vote on me.
If they vote yes, what happens?
Then I go to the Senate and the whole thing starts all over again.
Oh, no.
Oh, yeah. I'm just a bill. Yes, I'm on the... And if they vote for me on Capitol Hill, I'm off to the White House where I'm waiting online with a lot of other bills for the president to sign. And if he signs me, then I'll be alone. Hope and pray that he will, but today I am still just a bill.
You mean even if the whole Congress says you should be a law, the president can still say no?
Yes, that's called a veto. If the president vetoes me, I have to go back to Congress and they vote on me again, and by that time, you're so...
By that time, it's very unlikely that you become a law. It's not easy to become a law, is it?
No, but I hope and pray that I will. But today, I am still just a bill.
He signed your bill, now you're a law.
Oh, yes.
OK. Okay, sweet. So that's always gives me a good giggle. And for those who are visual learners, that might help kind of give you the visual of what it looks like as the bill goes through the different phases. So here's a summary of some of the main phases. There's always like a lot that's happening with bills from start to finish that can take years or months, but essentially you have the planning where a lot of the pre-work is happening. You're gathering your people, you're identifying the problem and the solution, you're identifying your strategy. And then you have the introduction where the bill is introduced in the center of the house. You have the committee that it's assigned to. Once the bill passes a bunch of votes, and then it goes to the governor to be signed or vetoed. And then the work isn't over and you're working on implementation. So let's dive in and talk about the bill introduction. So once a bill has gotten to the point where it's ready to be introduced, it'll be introduced either in the House or the Senate, and that depends on who's sponsoring the bill. For today, we'll say that the bill is introduced in the House. So the House Speaker, again, they'll decide which committee the bill will go to. And depending on the strategy, this could be a good time to educate the public about it. Some folks will keep bills on the DL because they don't want to bring negative attention to it. But for this sake, we'll say that this is an issue that we really want the public to know about and we want them to get excited about. So you can stay involved if you're not, if you're looking for things like, everyone has their different areas, their strong suits, where they feel comfortable, like maybe showing up to testify or showing up to, or like meeting with their legislator, writing emails, writing postcards. But at this point in the process, it's great to one, join the launch. If it's a big bill, a lot of folks will do a launch where they have a press conference, they invite the media to come and, you know, record and interview them about the bill. And then they do like a big social media campaign. And you can support that. You can be a part of the press conference. You can talk about it on your social media. You can educate your friends about it and basically just garner a lot of excitement. You can also tell your legislator, your senator, or your House representative how much you love the bill. And you can also tell the legislative champions that you appreciate them. Usually it's about 2 to 4 legislative champions. And you could tell them how awesome they are and give them the support they're going to need to push this bill through. So next slide. Once the bill is assigned to a committee, it'll go to that committee, which committees are typically smallish bipartisan groups of legislators. And these are legislators who typically have the most expertise or experience in that area. So for example, like the Appropriations Committee, they'll focus on financial costs and impacts of the bill. We're not going to go into all the committees, but that is a great thing to learn in the future and just get familiar with, because it can get intimidating to like think, you know, what are all these different committees and what do they do? But it is important to learn about that. In the committee, amendments can take place where legislators will add or take away components of the bill. And this is a crucial time for your participation, because if the bill has components of it that really are going to impact you and your community and you don't want them taken away, this is a great time to reach out to the bill or to the committee members and tell them, please do not change this part of the bill. This is important. This is a critical piece. It's also a great time to testify, to show up. As I mentioned earlier, I testified in a committee. You can make phone calls. And the difference here is you're contacting committee members who might not be your representatives in your district. So it's good to know who's in those committees and what issues they care about. At this point, you can also do letters to the editor where you're writing your personal story or your personal opinion, and you're posting on social media and you're trying to get news coverage. And then it goes back to the House. So we'll go to the next. So after it goes to committee, it's sent back to the House again with any of the new changes, and the entire House, 65 House representatives, vote on the bill. This is a great time to know how many votes you have. So if you're a lobbyist or a bill champion or an organization, this is where vote counting takes place. And you're checking to see, you know, who's going to support this bill, who's going to oppose it, where do we need to work on building relationships and doing some education with certain legislators, and where are we going to tap into community members to talk to their legislators about why this bill is important. Let's see. This could also be a good time to write to the governor. A lot of times the governor is like paying attention to what bills are going through committees. And he or she are going to be thinking about what parts of the bill they like, what parts they don't. And so you can always write to the governor at this point and say, hey, I really like this bill as is. Please do not change it. Please, I really appreciate your support. Thank you for caring about this issue. And then we'll go to the next slide. And then we have the bill signing and implementation. And so once the bill passes the Senate, it goes back to the House for a final vote. So the Senate is going to go through a very similar cycle that it went through in the House. And then it'll again go back to the House for a final vote. And once the House approves the new bill and all the changes, it's then sent to the governor, and he or she or they has 30 days to sign or veto the bill. Vetoes are not common, but they do happen. And if a governor vetoes a bill that's really important to you, that's a whole other discussion. But there's a lot of actions you can take to address that. A date will also set. Hello? A date will also be set for when the new law will go into effect. And then once it does go into effect, like I said, the work's not over. And so you're going to want to, first, it's great to thank your legislator champions for pushing the bill through. Thank your legislators if they voted yes. Remind them, like, this is a great issue for you to focus on, and just reinforce that positivity. And then also, and it will also encourage them to support similar issues. But then there's the implementation piece, and that's another great way to get involved. And that's educating folks on what the new law is and holding people accountable to following that law. And you can do that by helping create one pagers or trainings. You can do know your rights trainings. You can hold institutions and elected officials accountable, and you can host events. And there's just so many ways to educate the public in your community about what this law is. Next slide. And then, as we mentioned, and Sophia went over a lot of these questions, and but like a lot of the bill itself, like being drafted, it happens way before the bill's even introduced. And these are just some questions, you know, if you are part of a coalition, part of a campaign, these are some things that you can think of as you build a really successful strategy to where the bill is going through fairly quickly and has the support it needs. So you want to identify the problem, you know, and think like, is legislation the answer? If it's yes, you know, you're starting to build your team. Who are your people? Who does this impact? What legislators are going to champion this issue? You want to do a lay of the land. Who are my legislative champions? Is the bill bipartisan? How many legislators will support it, will oppose it? Where does the governor stand on the issue? What do the most impacted communities say about the issue? What issues do legislators care about? What issues did they get elected on? These are the kind of things that you also can ask as you're strategizing how to like pass a bill through certain committees. And then you'll create a strategy, and what is the pathway to victory, and what resources do we have, and where are we going to focus those resources? And then, of course, drafting the bill. So we're going to hop into an activity, and we don't need breakout rooms for this, so we'll go to the next page. And you can pull out a pen if you'd like, or you can just kind of look through the answers and come off mute. I'm going to encourage folks to... Oh, wait, actually, I realized. So we'll do the chat, if you can put in the chat. Sophia, can you go to the next slide? So the first We're the prompt is, what tactics would you use? And there's no wrong answers. This is really just like, what, based off of Sophia's training and my training, some of the ways that you can make sure that your voice is heard in the community, of your voice of your community is heard. What approach would you take to address these issues? So we'll say, for example, a bill is set to pass the House and the Senate, but word around the Capitol is the governor wants them to take out an important piece of the bill. What tactic would you use? So if you want to drop in the chat some ideas, feel free to get creative. It doesn't have to be just emailing the governor, or it could be that. And then we'll go on to the next one. So we got right the governor. We have folks would write their reps, post about it on social media. Oh, I like this. Someone would create a petition signed by bill supporters and community. Contact the governor, raise community awareness about the possible changes. Yes. Gather a bunch of community members together, all together to all request one-on-one meetings with the governor. Yes. Call the governor and share perspective and get people I know to do the same. Awesome. I love it. We got some organizers on the call. Flood the governor's office with phone calls. Yes. Organize a protest. Hold rally and invite press for visibility. Yes. Contact the media. That's awesome. These are all great. Cool. I think we got this tackled. The governor is going to support this after all of our efforts take place. So a new law just passed, and that's going to prevent landlords from evicting tenants without just cause. This is an actual bill. The problem is renters don't know that the law exists. What would you do? How would you educate your community? Door-to-door outreach, nice. And media publicity, yes. Post it on Nextdoor, that's a good one. Flyers, letter to the editor. Yes, whole community meetings. Yeah, community meetings are important. Weekend pop-ups, tabling in city centers like downtown and parks, yes. Where people are most impacted, that's a great way to approach it. Contact the local news, yes. Yeah, these are all great. And like, as you can see, one way is not the only way. And it's good to take a multi-layered approach to make sure that you're hitting all of the communities that are gonna be most impacted by this issue. Oh, nice. Liz, you're crushing it. Liz said for older renters, make sure AARP and local elder care agencies and companies know about it. Yes. Community members elected a legislator who promised that they would be a champion of civil rights and civil liberties, especially around criminal legal reform, but they just voted to re-felonize fentanyl. What do you do? Scream. That's great. Protest, yes. Die on their front lawn. Bring awareness via social media to vote them out next time. Yes, these are so good. Like, I need to save all of these. These are amazing. Yeah.
This is definitely how we're gonna write our next campaign plan, right, Julian?
I know. These are thank you, everyone. No, this is great. I want to see all of us like make this happen. Email, call the legislator, and voice frustration. Vote out next term. Yeah, like. We have the ability while electeds are in office to give them a really hard time about their actions, but it's also a great time to like be educating the community about what they're doing and why it's harmful so that the community knows, oh, I remember, like I'm not as involved in politics, but I remember that my good friend said that this legislator just voted to like criminalize people who might accidentally have a little fentanyl on them. And I'm not cool with that. And so I'm going to remember that name and I'm not going to vote for them next time. So it's a great way to like exercise your power, even though it happens every 2 to 4 years. And it doesn't feel as like, you know, reachable, but it is a great way to exercise your power through voting. And then finally, a dope law to repeal the 1981 rent control ban is heading to the House Transportation, Housing and Local Government Committee, where there are two champions, but the other 11 are undetermined. What would you do? And this is a great time where you can be doing some lay of the land research and finding out, you know, what legislators, how they've voted historically. And if it seems that you don't really have to worry about a certain legislator, you can focus on the ones where it's not clear. Contact my legislator about testifying. Nice. Find out what motivates the other 11. Yes. Mobilize people to testify. Yes. Yes. This is awesome. Collect 1,000 stories of self, us now, and deliver them to their office. Dope. I love that. Yeah, postcards and like letter writing. It's fun because you can get together and like have a we got flyers. Yeah. You can host parties. A lot of people around elections do ballot parties. But you can do this with like bills passing through committees. It's like host a postcard party. Host a phone bank with your friends, like great ways to contact legislators and let them know how you feel about certain issues. So thank you all for participating in this activity. Thank you for sticking with us all day. If you go to the next slide, we have a few other trainings coming up throughout the week. The big one is happening in person. It's going to be our day at the Capitol. And if you go to the next slide, Sophia, we can get the QR code. But we're going to do join us throughout the week. We have our lobby day at the Capitol. It's going to start at 8 a.m. We're going to have breakfast. We're going to have some legislators. We're going to talk about what lobbying is, what bills we're focusing on. And then we're going to go and we're going to like physically take you there to so you can get really familiar with what the Capitol looks like, what happens where, who's doing what, and then talk to some legislators about the bills you care about. So we hope you'll join us. If you have any questions, we'll pause for a moment and give folks a chance to drop some questions in the Q&A. Do you need ID? That's a great question. No, you do not need an ID. Thank you for asking, Anna. You don't need an ID. When you first get to the Capitol, there's a, you go through a little metal detector and then, you know, you're in, but they're not collecting names and they're not, you know, checking who you are. And there is a wheelchair accessible entrance. There might be two. And if you need a wheelchair accessible entrance, just let us know and we will make sure to point that out. And we might enter that way anyways. Can I bring my nine or two-wheeled scooter I use for mobility? I believe, I know scooters are good. I just don't know sizes. Does anyone on our team here know about 9 or 2-wheeled scooters?
I'm not sure, but our emails were put into the chat, Julian's in particular, but we would love to help make sure ahead of time for you that it does fit so that you don't end up having to deal with that on that day. So if you reach out to us and just remind us, like, I'm very, very happy to go have conversations at the Capitol to make sure that we can make that as smooth as possible.
Yeah. Yes. Liz, if you want to like, Liz and Layla, if you want to like send me your emails in the chat, if I can grab your emails, then I will contact you about those accommodations. Mary asked about meeting with reps. So we are going to be, a few reps are going to be coming to join us in our training sessions. And then we're going to go to the Capitol and we're going to try to find our reps. Sometimes they're going to be available and we'll get to talk to them. And then other times we might talk to their aides, which they are the ones who are always checking their emails, their phone calls, and they're telling the legislators like, hey, these are the issues that your constituents are contacting you about. So it's just as powerful and important. And yes, we would love, though, if reps are available to join. And we're trying to make that happen.
Yes, there's a handful of opportunities where reps will be joining us. And then when we're grassroots lobbying, we will be trying to pull them off the floor so that we can ensure that we touch base with them. But as Julian said, they can be hard to track down sometimes.
Cool. All right, any other questions? I see a question if the training sessions will be remotely accessible. The in-person one will not on Thursday, but the rest of the trainings throughout the week will be. And I encourage you to vote, join the story of self-training, which is happening on Wednesday. And that will be talking about how to give your story power. These trainings, we're going to be doing similar ones on Monday and maybe Tuesday, Sophia. Can you clarify? Okay.
Yes, correct. Basically, this was like a long one that has all of this content, and we're going to split it up and we'll have two short sessions, like 30 to 45 minutes, one on Monday, one on Tuesday. It's going to be about approximately the same content. And then, yes, the one on Wednesday is distinct. It's about storytelling and testimony and lobbying, which is going to be really great. And then, yeah, there's no virtual option for the day of the Capitol. Just logistically, it would be pretty impossible. All right, well, I think I'm gonna close this out, Julian, if you're all right with that.
Sounds great.
Thanks, well, I want, yeah, thank you to everybody. And I wanna give a really seriously shout out. I mean, I've already said this maybe a lot of times to you all, but I have been organizing for about a decade, and the way that people show up, give their time, their energy, their brain power to these kinds of spaces because they just care about what's happening in their community. They care about change. And in a lot of ways, I think of myself as a cynic, but when I think about this work, I know that I am actually an optimist because I show up every day knowing that if we work together, we can do it. And so thank you all for attending and for being here. And I hope to see you all in person. I hope to see you at the storytelling workshop. I am thrilled to have you all on this journey, even when, you know, when we align perfectly, when we don't align perfectly, that's how you make the best possible system, the best possible policy, the best possible democracy, and the best possible Colorado. It's all through you all. So thank you all for being here on our first day of Lift Week. And don't forget that lobbying is for the people.